Well, welcome to this video. In this video, I will be discussing regarding the normalization conditions and the completeness relations regarding these Spinor solutions that we have been discussing. So what we really saw was that we got two solutions of particle, or if we don't want to keep this notion of particle with before quantization, we can say we have two classical solutions of this form and two different classical solutions of this form, and they came from analyzing different frequencies. And the point is, so here the frequency associated with this one will be e power minus I omega t minus p dot x, and for this one here which is the antiparticle, it is e power I omega t minus p dot x. So they have opposite sign here, one is plus I dot something and one is minus. And here the another thing is important is that here this s that I have written, for s equal to 1 you have one solution of particle, then you take this as x1, and s equal to 2 you have the second solution of the particle, and that is this like the 0 qubit and the 1 qubit. And for vs it is opposite, the 1 and 2 they are opposite, and so this opposite nature, it arised from looking at this helicity or chirality, we can say. So now proceeding, what we will do is we will try to just calculate this sum that I am showing here. So you are summing over the linearly independent particle solutions, and so this kind of a thing is almost like a normalization. If you think of in quantum mechanics, we have psi psi, and then we take mod square, and then we say it is equal to 1. What we are doing is we are doing some sort of a U dagger normalization. So let's see. So what we need to do is, so this didn't came out correctly. So the normalization is just psi is 1. So I was thinking in terms of measurement. Anyway, so this also has u in it, and this has u dagger and a gamma zero. And we really saw that while discussing the Lagrangian of the Dirac equation, we saw that psi bar psi is something that is invariant instead of dagger u dagger u. So let's calculate this quantity. So what we can do is we will just expand it. So suppose S is 1, then we have this kind of a just rewritten this quantity here, and this is the gamma 0 in Dirac basis, the gamma 0. And now we will just take the form of U here, US, our particle solutions. And suppose I am calculating the first term, so S is 1, so I will just take this one. So I have kept it a bit general, because even if the particle is second solution, it is still chi here. So now we will take this thing and just perform this multiplication. So multiplying these two will give this negative sign here, and I will get here, and now I need to multiply these two. So you see, now you see x dagger, this x is in Hilbert space of 2 dimension, so it is like a projection. So let's just call it projection, like px associated with chi. If chi is 1 0, or suppose chi is 0 and chi dagger then is 0, then this projector is nothing but 0 0. So like this we will have this term everywhere, because we have a chi dagger here and a chi in both of the term here, and so we have 4 different elements. So this matrix is a 4 cross 4 matrix, if you notice, because each of these chi's are itself 2 cross 2 matrix. So this is, for example, 1, 0, 0, 0. So now what we will do is, we will, so the second spin, s equal to 2, that will also give this same kind of a term, but here the projector will just be 1, 1. So that means when we sum this, we can take this denominator omega plus m outside the summation, and as we sum this, we will get the sum of two projectors here and here. And this is just the identity operator. So what we finally end up getting is this thing. Here you see this is a 4 cross 4 matrix with a 2 cross 2 identity operator. So now this matrix has a very nice form, which is visible by just splitting the matrix. So you see, you can take m times identity outside, you can take this outside, and then you can inside this matrix, what you can do, you can just write them in terms of gamma 0 and gamma I, where split is basically using the Dirac basis. From going from here to here, we have used the form of Dirac basis, but you see, the zeroth component of momentum is just the energy or this omega, and the other components are pi. So this is p slash notation. So this is the Feynman slash notation that essentially is the short form of gamma mu p mu. So the important point to see here is that first we can get rid of this thing. So we fix the normalization such that our normalized spinors are root over this quantity in the numerator. So when we multiply them, this numerator and denominator, they will cancel. And essentially, after normalization, our final summation of this spin is of this form, p slash plus m. And similarly, we can perform this entire procedure with the antiparticle solution, which the difference is that the antiparticle solutions have this kind of a term in the numerator, like in the upper part instead of the lower part. So what this means is that we end up getting these two normalization conditions that I have shown here. But you see, these are manifestly basis invariant because they don't ascertain any basis a priori. So you see, p slash is just telling you gamma mu p mu summation. So whatever basis you choose, if you remember that you are expanding these solutions in that basis, then automatically the basis fact is taken care of. So these normalizations are something that is basis invariant, whether you work in the chiral basis or the whale basis or the Dirac basis. Now we follow one more observation. That observation is that, so here what I did, that I summed over u bar. So this is a matrix quantity, but you see, u bar u, so this thing, what it will give, so if you see, so what it does is that you have 2 cross 1, and this is 2 cross 2, and you have here 1 cross 2. So essentially, it gives me a scalar quantity. So this is obvious because psi bar psi is a scalar, and the scalar quantity can again be computed in the similar fashion we went through all this calculation above. So I have written here, but here we have to take into account the explicit normalization factor, that is this root omega plus m. So similar thing can be done for antiparticle, and we see the particle solutions satisfy a condition. So you can call it, so this condition is like a summation. So this is not really a condition. So using this condition, we fix some sort of a normalization, and using that, we fix this the normalization condition finally comes out to be psi bar psi equal to 2L. So same thing can be done for the antiparticles. So the linearly independent antiparticle solutions, for whatever value of spin you take, this is important, you end up getting this kind of a solution. So yes, maybe I have not mentioned. So what we can write is u n bar s u n r is 2 times m delta s r. So this is really ortho normalization condition of spinners. But the delta factor is obvious, because if r and s are not similar, then they basically live in different parts of this bispinor component. So, and finally what we can see is the particle solution and the antiparticle solution themselves are also orthogonal. So they are normalized and they are orthogonal. So these are like, we can say these are the orthonormal solutions. So with this understanding, we just at the end summarize the entire discussion of this solutions of Dirac equation. So we had a Dirac equation and we needed to find the solution of this particular quantity. And what we found was that a general solution of Dirac equation can be written as in a basis form of two frequencies. So these are plane wave solutions of two frequencies. One is positive frequency and negative frequency. And the positive frequency was associated with the particles and the negative with the antiparticles, where this is the Minkowski dot product. So after we have come till this much, the P0 is the energy and that is positive for both the case, particle, antiparticle. And the P mu, that is essentially this that we all know, E square minus P square is M square. So that solution is M square. Now further what we saw is that even within, so we got two solutions, positive and negative. And within each of these solution, we had two more linearly independent solution. Basically, these solutions belong to this 1 and 2 are essentially coming from this fact that you have a 1, 0 or you have a 0, 1. So, because a Hilbert space of 2 dimension has 2 basis vector. So, this gave us essentially 4 linearly independent solution. And they are normalized in this particular fashion. This is the normalization for antiparticle, this is the normalization for particle, and they satisfy this particular completeness relation. So completeness relation in the sense you have in general, you have suppose 0 0 plus 1 1 plus dot 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 m for a m dimensional Hilbert space as identity. And finally, they are mutually orthonormal also. So this is the entire understanding of the solution. And you see this understanding that I am showing now, this is not basis dependent. So whatever basis you choose, you will have 4 solutions, 2 particle, 2 antiparticle, 4 linearly independent solutions. And these solutions are normalized in this particular fashion. And they satisfy this particular completeness relation. So that's all for this video.